A woman is different from a man in ways that kind of stem from how she was created. First of all, she was created from Adam's rib. And so obviously, physically, there's some differences, right? She wasn't created to be a clone of Adam. She was created from Adam. And I think the physical differences are evident. But even more than that, I think when you look at her being a suitable helper, God created women in this powerful role to be a helper. It didn't say a servant, right? It didn't say a slave. It said a helper. And when you think about helping someone, you bring some powerful qualities to the table. And I think some of those qualities for a woman are that women are great responders, right? When there's something going on, women can step in and they can help. And obviously, we know, we've seen through history, men are really initiators in a lot of ways, in relationships, in war, you know, in good ways and in bad ways. And women often respond to those ways, whether it's a relationship or something larger in society, to create solutions.
See, Jesus often talked about the point of your life is not for you and you alone. There's something bigger. In one point, Matthew chapter 16, there at Caesarea Philippi, in a city up north, and Jesus asked his disciples, "Hey, who do you say that I am?" And Peter says, "You are Christ, the Son of the living God, the Messiah. You come from God." And then Jesus says, "You're correct." And then he says, "Now I must go to Jerusalem and I'm going to lay down my life and die." And Peter goes, "No, no, 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 no. That's not in our plan. You know, you're going to deliver us, set up a political kingdom, and we're going to rule alongside of you." And Jesus says, "Get thee behind me, Satan, for you're focused on what you want and not the will of God, God's mission or God's plan." And then Jesus turns to all of his disciples and he says the following words. He says, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross." And that word cross, take up your cross, you know, people would carry their cross to their crucifixion. He says they must pick up their cross and follow me. "For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me will find it."
ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jesse Mayer, and I am the host of the Salty Pastor Podcast, a podcast dedicated to helping you learn to think for yourself, develop critical thinking skills, and grow your faith along the way. But a lot of what we're doing in the meantime is telling a lot of jokes and having a lot of fun.
And in your 30s is when you start dealing with all of the shortcomings of what happened in your life.
Preach, Pastor. As a 30-something-year-old, I'm feeling some of these that you're saying.
Yeah. And so, hey, we can always have fun. I'm Dr. Douglas Peake, and I've been in the ministry for over 35 years. And what I have learned is that the best way for your faith to grow is for you to know what you believe and why you believe it. And that's what the Salty Pastor is all about. We dig into the Bible, and then we apply it to our contemporary world.
So if you want to grow your faith and have confidence in what you believe, join us every Tuesday and Thursday here on The Salty Pastor. It's available wherever you get your podcasts or on YouTube.
I'm Shelley Britton. I want to welcome you to Foothills Christian Church. We are a church located in Boise, Idaho, but our ministry has been moving across the state, the nation, and even across the globe. It is absolutely amazing to see what God has chosen to do through this community of people focused solely upon Jesus. We are continuing our brand new series, At the Movies, this week. Our culture loves to talk about, discuss, rate, and engage with movies. But what if we could take these primarily secular experiences and use them to convey the truth of Scripture in a new way? That is the whole idea behind the series. Take familiar movies and use them to shed light on principles that have been communicated through Scripture for hundreds of years. If you are new or if you would like to know more about us, it's easy. Just scan the QR code and text FHNEW to 72000. We love to introduce ourselves to you and have you be a part of our community of faith. So let's get ready to worship and celebrate together.
Life can be heavy, a burden which at times seems unbearable. It's easy to find ourselves overwhelmed, weighed down, or even crushed. Often these struggles come and go, a nuisance, an annoyance, yet sometimes they grab a hold, gripping every aspect of our lives, pulling us down, consuming our hope. It's hard to breathe under the weight of our anxieties. It's difficult to move forward when we're anchored to our worries. But God loves us too much to let us stay this way. He wants to replace our anxiety with hope, our fear with courage, our worries with peace, and our burdens with freedom. In moments when life begins to weigh you down, remember this one simple truth. We serve a faithful God, a God who's offered to carry our burdens and asks us to cast all our cares on Him.
Well, good morning, Foothills. Why don't you stand and join us? So good to be with you today. Let's worship. Oh,
Better than you, Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from
seat. How about this band? Let's give them applause. Such an incredible team we have here. Hey, we want to take a second just to talk to you about worship here at Foothills. You know, everybody here in the body has a different calling to ministry and serving, and we just want to address those of you who may be interested in joining our worship team, whether you sing or play an instrument. We would love to meet you. We have a booth set up in the foyer where you can come meet Ashley or I and just talk to us about the different opportunities we have. We'd love to meet you. We'd love to grow our team. We just have been so blessed with amazing congregation here and amazing worship team members. And if you are interested even in the littlest bit in serving here at Foothills on the worship team, we'd love to meet you. So after service, come talk to us, come shake our hand, and we'd love to talk to you then.
If you're on campus, please be seated. If you are doing church at home or watching online, now is the time to get your communion elements ready. If you are on campus, you may have noticed that we have switched our communion elements to a higher quality product that is easier to open. We still have the same commitment to safety and sanitation, but we also wanted something that was easier to use. The reason we observe the Lord's Supper each week is because it's your time to personally connect to Jesus and reflect on the reason why you could walk in new life. None of us have the ability to make dead things live, but Jesus has the power to take a dead heart and bring it back to life. Because Jesus died and rose from the dead, you and I now have the invitation to move from death to life. This ceremony is all about how Jesus makes it all possible. Follow the instructions on the screen and be sure to think about how the resurrection of Jesus is an offer for you to live a new life. Let's begin. Dear Jesus, thank you. Thank you that you didn't leave us dead in our sin, that you came to live that perfect life and to take our punishment on the cross so that we could have a life abundant, eternal, and all-consuming. Thank you so much for all that you've done. Amen.
Hello, Foothills family. How are we this morning, this rainy day? My name is Jesse Mayer. If you don't know me, I'm the Creative Arts Director here, and I have a very exciting announcement. We are such a large congregation. We have people all across the country that are part of our congregation. All of your beautiful faces are part of our congregation. The live stream, hello. But we are actually adding one more person to our Foothills family. And Nick, you want to come out? We want to make a quick announcement that Ashley is actually pregnant. So, and it's a boy. So we are growing by one. So if you don't see Ashley for a little bit at some point, that's because not because she left. It's she still loves you. She's coming back. She's just got a new little one that her and Nick, her husband, are going to be taking care of. So we wanted to announce this great news to you guys, let you know that they are adding someone to their family and ours. So thank you guys so much, and let's send it back to the host.
Thank you. we were able to interview one of our missionaries that we support from Casa de Fe Mission in Ecuador. Here's a snippet from the much larger and inspiring interview that you could watch on our YouTube channel.
Hi, I'm Patty Arnold from Ecuador. I run Casa de Fe, a children's home for abandoned, abused, and special needs children in the Amazon rainforest. If you've ever spent time at Casa de Fe, you know Tatiana. Her bubbly personality, ready smile, and tenacious spirit make a mark on everyone who encounters her. However, most people have not heard her story. She has endured incredible struggles throughout her life, and those struggles have molded her into the amazing young lady that she is today. Tatiana was brought to Casa de Fe by the police after a neighbor notified them that a child was living under a house with the dogs. When the homeowner, Tatiana's uncle, was questioned about her living conditions, he responded, if she wanted to come into the house, she could have. Like most homes here, the house was built on stilts due to the high annual rainfall. Between the height of the house and Tatiana's physical limitations, there was no way that she could have entered her uncle's home unassisted. When Tatiana arrived at Casa de Fe in November 2005, she was 3 years old and weighed just 15 pounds. She could barely sit up and moved around only by scooting. Tatiana was extremely malnourished and the skin on her back was infested with botfly larvae. She was born with cerebral palsy and had malformations in her brain that caused balance issues and affected the muscles and tendons of her face. When Tatiana arrived at Casa de Fe, she was in the worst condition of any child who I had ever received at Casa de Fe up to that point. With a nutritious diet and the investment of caring Casa de Fe staff, Tatiana began to respond immediately. She started to gain weight and the larvae were removed from her back, and she began physical therapy to learn how to stand. Thanks to the generous support of one of our donors, Tatiana received a walker in 2006 and thrived. She was soon motoring about and bringing joy to everyone. Within a year, Tatiana had reached the developmental milestones appropriate for a four-year-old born with her conditions, and she was walking completely independently. Tatiana is now 20 years old and continues to grow into a beautiful young lady. In 2017, she had a wonderful quinceañera, a celebration of a girl's 15th birthday, which marked her passage into womanhood. In 2020, she graduated from the special needs school in Puyo. Today, Tatiana is quite the diva, and although she still has many challenges, she is a determined and tenacious young lady. She loves helping in the kitchen and working with the babies and special needs children. She has a compassionate heart and an infectious joy. I'm sure if you have visited Casa de Fe in the last 18 years, Tatiana has left her mark on your heart. I do know he has amazing plans for their lives, and Casa de Fe will be there to love them as long as God sees fit to keep them with us. And that is certainly a measure of success in his kingdom.
We want to take a moment to thank every single person who gives generously to see the kingdom of God grow in ways we never imagined, like these inspirational stories of children in Ecuador that we are able to help directly because of your generosity. If you want to learn more about how giving can help you grow spiritually, text FHGIVE to 72,000. Now let's continue our new series, At the Movies with Pastor Doug.
Welcome. I'm Douglas Peake, and it's good to be with you today. We want to especially welcome all of you who might be visiting for the first time, watching online, or doing church at home. And we're in a series called At the Movies. We're throughout the entire summer. We're going to be taking a look at various movies and the biblical principles from which they come from. As a biblically oriented church, where our goal is to get you as familiar with the Bible as possible, why would we use movies? Well, first of all, it's fun. You know, that's always kind of a nice incentive. But also, it's an excellent way to show you one of our core values and how it works. One of our core values here is our goal is not to tell people what to think. We want to tell people what music to listen to, what they have to eat, all the things they have to think in order to be right with God. Our goal is to help you think for yourself because it's your faith. And you need to learn how to walk in the fullness of what it means to know God and be His disciple. So what happens is by using movies, what we do is we are showing how real life allows us to wrestle with the core values that we have. That's called an upstream idea or concept. And that is, we want you to think for yourself by clarifying your core values, understanding your faith, understanding your walk with God. It's in real life where we wrestle with these core values, and stories, particularly movies that resonate with us, always expose this process. And that's one of the reasons why we love stories and why we love movies and why we love TV shows and books and novels about interesting things, is it helps expose how our own struggle with our core values manifests itself in real life. So that's why we do this. And I believe that all good stories, ones that really resonate with the greatest amount of people, come from a biblical principle. And when we go back and find out what these biblical principles are, it helps us understand how to clarify our own values. Now, if you're new and you'd like to get to know us, all you got to do is scan this QR code and you can get a little bit of an understanding of who we are anonymously. It's very quick, a few short videos, right, delivered to your phone. Also, something else that I think is kind of a big deal that's going on is a lot of people are wondering, with the economy and what it's doing, how do I understand my own personal generosity? You got to see one of the ministries that our missions department has worked closely with and supported. And so this is an opportunity to learn how to navigate that. You can just scan that QR code or text FH Giving to 72,000. It's not an ask. It's not an invitation. It's just simply pure teaching on how to help you determine how to be generous in the kingdom of God. Now, we today are going to be talking about one of my favorite childhood characters, and that is Spider-Man. Oh, I loved Spider-Man growing up. The reason why is because his story is so compelling. You know, he's an intelligent, socially awkward teenager. He lost his parents, so he grew up with his elderly Aunt May and Uncle Ben. And he has all these people that he cares about, but he can't talk to them. And he gets bit by a radioactive spider. Now, is that realistic or what? Right? And so he develops superpowers that are very similar to a spider. So they call him Spider-Man. I don't know if you know this, but there are 8 movies about Spider-Man that have just come out in the last 10 to 15 years, played by 3 different actors. The first one was Tobey Maguire, and there were 3 Spider-Man movies. Then there was Andrew Garfield, and he did 2 Spider-Man movies. And then now there's Tom Holland, and he's done 3 Spider-Man movies. And so we're going to focus on the very last, the 8th movie in all 8 of them. It's called Spider-Man No Way Home, and I want you to get a feel for it.
Ever since I got bit by that spider, I've only had 1 week where my life has felt normal. That was when you found out.
When you botched that spell where you wanted everyone to forget the Peter Parker Spider-Man, we started getting some visitors. every universe. Hello, Peter. You're not Peter Parker.
I'm sorry, what was your name again?
Dr. Otto Octavius.
Wait, no, seriously, what's your actual name?
There are others out there. We need to send them back. So, Scooby-Doo this crap.
You know, all this is kind of your mess. I know a couple of magic words myself, starting with the word please.
Please, Scooby-Doo this crap. You're flying out into the darkness to fight ghosts.
What do you mean?
They all die fighting Spider-Man. It's their fate. I'm sorry, kid.
Yeah, me too.
Don't.
Look, there has to be another way.
There isn't. They're a danger to our universe.
You're not gonna take this away from me.
Peter, you're struggling to have everything you want while the world tries to make you choose.
This is all my fault. I can't save everyone.
Well, that makes you want to go out and see the movie all over again, I hope. If you're not familiar with the story, the story arc of Spider-Man is wrestling with some really big themes. And the first one is, how would your life change if you received superpowers? You know, and here's this teenager, and he receives this really incredible gift, and then what happens is he wrestles with the implications of that in all different ways. Number two, in this movie, it's how does your desire to help actually help? Because in some way he tried to help, and it just made matters worse. And then it deals with how do you deal with the mistakes of the past? You see, in this last movie, we pick up with the fact that his identity, his secret identity is revealed. So everybody now knows that Peter Parker is Spider-Man. And this causes his friends, his two close friends, Ned, his best friend, and his love interest, which is MJ, to lose their opportunity to go to college. So they were rejected by all of their colleges because they were close friends of him. So what he does, he goes to this weird guy, Dr. Strange, and says, hey, can you fix the past? And it goes terribly wrong. And you saw in the trailer what happens is every villain from every movie in this universe, they have all these multiple universes, which is stretching reality, I know that. But what happens is it brings all of these villains into his world, villains he doesn't even know. And so now he's trying to fix the past a second time by sending all these people back. So he picks these people, or he tries to fix his past because it negatively affects his friends. But in doing that, he ends up, this experiment goes terribly wrong, and all these villains from all these different realities end up in his, and they're wreaking havoc on the city and all these innocent people. And so all he wants to do now is try to send them back, get rid of them, so that he can pretend all of this doesn't happen. And one of his biggest villains in all the comic books is the Green Goblin, right? And the Green Goblin is crazy. He has two personalities, and one of them is the father of his best friend, who he is pretty normal. He's a scientist. The other one is crazy and destructive. And so what's interesting about it is in this reality, the Green Goblin, he kind of reverts back to his normal self, and he's asking for help, right? And Spider-Man sees him with Aunt May. He's worried. All he wants to do is get rid of him. But his Aunt May challenges him to rethink his strategy. Let's watch.
Hey, Foothills family, welcome back. We are unable to show the clips that we're seeing in the auditorium online due to copyright issues, but I'm gonna give you a brief overview of what's happening in the clip. In the clip, Spider-Man, or Peter Parker, walks into this shelter that Aunt May runs. And the Green Goblin, who has been a major source of controversy, who caused problems on the bridge, is in there saying he doesn't know where he's at, doesn't know how he got here, and Aunt May says, do all of the villains that are in the world right now that have come over have these issues? And he says, yeah, they all have some physical or mental issue. And he says, I'm just gonna send them all back. They're not my problem. And she says, no, you are uniquely set up with power and responsibility to help them. So Pastor Doug's gonna elaborate a little bit more back in the auditorium.
So you see, he's now wrestling with this notion of how do I fix my past and what is to do the best thing. And this is kind of the first, I think, biblical principle that this entire dilemma that he's going through comes from, and that is this notion in Christianity that you can never change your past. You can only redeem it. You can never change it or fix it. You can only redeem it. And all great stories that we like, all great movies, are always stories about what? Redemption. And that's why the story of Jesus Christ is often referred to as the greatest story ever told. In Acts chapter 3:19, the author of the book of Acts is quoting one of the apostles who is preaching. And this apostle says in chapter 3:19, he says, repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out. Now, notice what he says. He doesn't say, so we go back and fix your past. It doesn't say we're going to go back and change your past. He says what we're going to do is we're going to go back and wipe it clean. And you do that for one purpose, so that times of refreshing may come from the Lord. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, Paul writes, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation is come. The old is gone and the new is here. So he's saying that when you come to Christ in redemption, your old past is washed away and you are made new. Last week, we talked about the principle of how we are brought from death to life when we meet Jesus Christ and are redeemed by his blood. So he goes, all of this is from God, verse 18. All of this is from God. So God does this, who reconciled us to himself through Jesus, and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. So what happens when we come and we meet God? We are reconciled to him. And what this does is this redeems our past. So your journey of faith for every human being out there in regards to God is a journey of redemption. And that's a very important truth, is that we must embrace the fact that we cannot fix our past. We ultimately can't even pay a penance for our past. All we can do is allow our past to be redeemed. And the only one who has the power to redeem our past is Jesus Christ himself. This is a very important biblical principle. It's been around for thousands of years. It's what sets Christianity apart from every philosophy, every belief system, worldview, or religion. In every philosophy, in every belief system, in every other religion other than Christianity, you have to earn, you see, your salvation. You have to earn it. You have to follow certain rules and regulations to the point where your devotion is based upon your compliance with these things. So it puts all the emphasis for your redemption on you and your capacity to make yourself holy. This is called seeking a righteousness of your own. Here's what's really fascinating, is Paul in Philippians chapter 3, he says, look, if anybody could have a righteousness of their own, it would be me. He goes, my pedigree is off the charts. I'm smarter than all the other Jewish people. I'm more accomplished. I'm more devoted. I'm more zealous. I follow the law better than most people. And he goes, what I found out is the truth of what Christ said, and that is no matter how hard I try, there's no way in heaven I'll be able to do it. There's no way I will ever be able to do it because I can never make myself complete and holy. And that's why he says, I don't want a righteousness of my own. I want one that comes from Jesus. I want to know the power of his sufferings so that I can know the power of his resurrection. Because the power of his resurrection is what makes me whole. So this is really interesting, especially if you raise children. Because when you're raising children, you're trying to get them to accept the fact that there is a cause-effect relationship between their choices, their behavior, and the outcome, right? Which is very important. You have to do that. But what happens is when you become an adult, you realize, well, I can't ever be perfect, and so who makes up the rest? Well, your past can't be changed. It can only be redeemed. What happens when you're not perfect as an adult and you look back and you go, wow, how do I fix the past? You can't. It can only be redeemed. And this truth has changed people for thousands of years. You know, what happens if you grow up in a situation, right, where you are the victim of somebody else's sinful choices, right? You grow up in a toxic situation or an abusive situation or a less than desirable situation, right? You experience tragedy or loss in how you grow up. How in the world do you ever overcome that? Well, in many ways, you can't because you can't go back and change the past. But through the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, he can redeem your past and heal your past. What happens if you're following Jesus and you make mistakes? You know, Paul talks about this in Romans chapter 7 where he says, you know, I have this real big issue in my life right now. And he goes, that is that I know what I want to do, the good stuff, but then I end up doing the opposite. He goes, what's up with that? And he says, who will deliver me from this wretched body of death, right? Because I keep doing what I don't want to do instead of doing what I want to do. Do you ever have that issue when you're dieting? Right? I don't know about you, but so often it's like, man, I eat when I'm not supposed to instead of eating when I'm supposed to. Do you have that issue with your training workout? Right? This is what I should be doing, but I'm not. I'm doing what I don't want to do. And so, boy, chips and sports on a Saturday afternoon are so much more comfortable than going to the gym. Right? We do this all the time. Why do we do this in our relationships? We do it in our parenting. We do it. We all make mistakes. So how in the world do you continue to find the energy and the passion and the mission and the inspiration to keep going, to keep growing, to keep trying? Well, you do that because you are living in a redemptive relationship with God, right? He's saying, I have healed you and restored you, and now what I want you to do is learn how to walk and live in this new life. Take off the old and put on the new. You see, you can't ever change your past. You can only redeem it. And the way that you make sure your past doesn't influence your future is you walk and live in redemption. Now, let's go to the next theme that we're going to pick up. Peter Parker, of course, decides, hey, we're not going to send all these villains back to their own realities because they all die fighting Spider-Man. So we're going to help them. He says, I've been given this power. I'm also smart. I'm going to now help. What's really interesting is the other Spider-Man characters come into his reality. So now we have three Spider-Men, right? And they're sitting there thinking, we're going to help these people, right? So they're all like, okay, before we go back, we want to be helped, we want to be healed. But one of them deceives them, and that is the Green Goblin, right? The bad guy comes back, and what happens is he attacks Peter Parker, and his Aunt May is there, and in this process, she is mortally wounded. In the story arc of every Spider-Man, he always loses his Uncle Ben. And this one, it's his Aunt May. And these people represent the moral anchor of who he is as a teenager, all right? So the Goblin is taunting him for being a do-gooder, for trying to help when they shouldn't have tried to help, for doing the right thing when doing the right thing is worthless and doesn't make any difference. And so his Aunt May, right before she dies, quotes a very powerful statement that happens in every story about Spider-Man. Let's watch.
Now, in this clip, we see destruction after all of the villains have decided to betray Peter and go on a rampage. And in this clip, Peter says, oh my gosh, I should have just sent them back. I should have known that they would betray me. They were evil to their core. There's no way I could have thought I could have made a difference. And May says, no, that is not the way to think about this. You tried. You used your power for good. And even though it didn't work out, you still had the responsibility to try. It's very easy just to walk away. It is much harder and the right thing to do to stay and fight and try. And she gives the iconic line that we've seen in every Spider-Man movie. Up until this point, we haven't seen it in this particular remake, but she says, with great power comes great responsibility. And as they limp off, both injured, Peter kind of starts understanding that maybe his life isn't always going to be easy or fun, or his ability to just spend time with his friends isn't always going to be without its risks. So I'm going to send you back into the auditorium so Pastor Doug can elaborate a little bit more on these thoughts.
So that's the line, with great power comes great responsibility. And what's really interesting is we all think, wow, if I was a superhero or I had superpowers, then I'm sure my life would be different, or I would have to figure out my responsibility. Well, what if I told you that you already have a superpower? In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7, it says this, the end of all things is near, therefore you need to be alert and of sober mind so that you can pray. If you ever felt like, you know, things are unraveling in your own life or unraveling in the nation in which you live or unraveling in this world, then you're pretty sensible. You need to be sober about that. Why? Because you want to understand verse 8. Above all, love each other deeply because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. And then verse 10 is what I call the golden nugget. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received. So you have received a gift in order to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If you go over to Romans chapter 1, verse 10, Paul is writing the Romans, and he says, in my prayers at all times, I pray that now, at last, by God's will, the way may be opened for me to come to you. So he's saying, I want to come visit you, is what he's saying. I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. So you have faith, and the purpose of your faith, one of the things it does is not only guide you, but it encourages other people. And that's because you've been given a spiritual gift by God that makes you strong. You have a gift, whether you know it or not, whether you believe it or not. When you come to faith in Jesus Christ and are redeemed by his blood, you receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And in that gift is a special, unique ministry, a unique thing that only you can do. So there is a tremendous amount of fun in discovering your special power and what it is, this unique gift that only you have been given by God. There is meaning in your life when you discover it. But all of this requires you to embrace your responsibility. And at the end of the movie, Peter starts to accept the fact that he's been given this gift, and it's not just an addendum to his life where he just goes on happily doing his own thing, but has deep ramifications. And so I want you to watch this clip, and then I'm going to explain it to you. But it's at the very end where the only solution is to make everybody forget that Peter Parker ever existed, and then he's going to come back and try to remedy that. Let's watch the end.
Hey, Foothills family, in these clips that are being shown in the auditorium, we're doing two back-to-back. So I'm going to explain both of them so that you have some context when we go back into the auditorium. The first clip is after the giant battle with all of the villains, and they've defeated or cured all of them at this point. But the destruction of the multiverse is starting to tear the world apart. He made a mistake and the whole world is falling apart. And Doctor Strange says, I don't think I can stop this. And Peter finally says, I think I know how we can do this. What if you erase me from everybody's memories? What if you get rid of Peter Parker entirely? And Strange says, well, that will work, but none of us will remember you. And he says, just do it. Give me some time to say goodbye, but just do it. So Peter swings down to say goodbye to his friends, and he lands, and Ned and MJ are there. They're both injured. They both fought valiantly in this battle, but they're injured. This was never supposed to happen this way. They were supposed to be safe, and yet they still got hurt somehow. Now, Peter says, I have to do this. The world's falling apart. You're going to forget me. And Ned and MJ are both like, there's got to be another way. There's got to be some way to stop this. And Peter says, there isn't. This is the only way I can think of how to keep the world turning. And so he says, I'm going to make this sacrifice. And he turns to them. He says, I'm going to make this sacrifice, but I promise I will come back for you. I will come and find you, and I will remind you who I am. And he, and Ned and MJ both look at him, and they're looking and trying to see if this is true. And with all their heart, they believe that he will. And they say, I will see you on the other side. We cut to a second clip. This is at the end of the movie, after everyone's memory has been wiped of Peter. It's him walking along the street. He's holding a piece of paper, reciting this speech that he wrote to reintroduce himself to MJ and Ned. And as he walks into this coffee shop where MJ is working, there's this brief moment where he thinks, maybe she still remembers me. But it's actually Ned behind him that she recognizes. And as they go to talk and sit down, she's so excited about this idea of going to MIT. It's the thing that they had been denied earlier in the movie because they knew who Peter was. It was a sacrifice they had to make because they even just knew who Peter Parker was and what he had been accused of. And so as Peter's watching this interaction of MJ, who constantly expects disappointment, but is finally excited about something for once, he starts having second thoughts. And as she comes up, asks for his order and gets him a coffee, he's really debating it, and he decides that he's gonna give the speech. He wants to be with them so bad. But as he goes to pay for his coffee, he pulls out the speech of his back out of his back pocket, and as he's about to start giving it, MJ pulls her hair to the side and he sees this Band-Aid there. And that Band-Aid is covering a wound she received in their battle. And he says, are you okay? And she says, yeah, it doesn't hurt anymore. And at that exact moment, you can see something switch within Peter, where he realizes maybe his friends would be safer if they didn't know who he was. Maybe his family would be safer if they didn't know who he was. And he struggles. You see this great acting moment from Tom Holland where you really see the turmoil of him trying to decide whether he should tell them. And he says, nothing, never mind. And he puts the speech away and walks out the door. He chooses to make a sacrifice so that everyone else can be safe. Now, I'm going to send you back into the auditorium so Pastor Doug can explain more about why this scene is so important.
On this, you can listen to the Salty Pastor episode that dropped on Thursday. But basically, what happens is he has this piece of paper. He's written this big speech on it. He's going to try to help them remember. But then when he gets there, he sees this Band-Aid because she got cut helping him. And then she says, it doesn't hurt anymore. And that's a revelation to him. Then they do a close-up on the coffee that says, we are happy to serve you. And what he comes to this realization is, by telling her or helping her remember, I could end up hurting her more than if she never knew. So he makes a massive sacrifice and gives up on his normal life. And this is really important because our society has lost this notion, and that is everything in your life requires a sacrifice. Our society doesn't want one. In Romans chapter 12, verse 1, it says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is true and proper worship. This is true and proper worship. Now, one of the problems we have is called the Peter Pan syndrome today. This is men who don't want to grow up because men don't want to have to do anything. But in order to become a man, in order to become a woman, you have to do something. You have to accept responsibility for something. Otherwise, you remain Peter Pan in the island of lost boys. They are named that appropriately. But if you start to do things and you accept responsibility for something you're doing without knowing what your special power is, then everything you do will be a disappointment or frustrate you because you have not answered the question why. You have to know why you do what you're doing, and that is just as important as what it is that you are doing. And this is how you avoid the Peter Pan syndrome. The Peter Pan syndrome is another archetype or common pattern that people fall into all the time. You see, the Peter Pan syndrome is when a man or a woman who is an adult is rejecting responsibility and they end up pursuing what is commonly known as low-class impulsive pleasure. The problem with pursuing low-class and impulsive pleasure is it always results in self-contempt. You have no respect for yourself. It also results in nihilism. Now, our society today is particularly robbing boys of the opportunity to accept and value responsibility. You see, our society today tells boys that, look, you're oppressive and toxic, so don't be a man. Well, then why would any boy want to make any sacrifice, right? If there's no net gain or any benefit to accepting responsibility and growing to maturity, why do it? You see? So if a boy gets no credit for trying, then why play? Why not just stay on the island of lost boys? And that's what they do. Why not, like Pinocchio, go to Pleasure Island? The problem is when you stay there, you end up with self-contempt. You see, the challenge is that we tend to avoid sacrifice as much as possible. I get it. However, it's only through sacrifice that we discover the true power of the gift that we've been given. So ultimately, the question becomes, what sacrifice are you willing to make? And that is this, the sacrifice, everyone makes a sacrifice, right? But that there's no choice in that. The real choice is that you get to choose what sacrifice you make. It's like this. The final thing I'd like to just share is like this, is that if you were to look at your entire life, you are writing a story. Whether you want it to or not, you're writing a story. Your very existence is a story. There's no choice in that. What story are you writing? Now, there's a lot of choice in that. You know, Spider-Man shows us this trajectory that we have been given a huge gift by God through the power of the Holy Spirit. We need to accept responsibility for its implications in our life. And only when we do that will we ultimately understand who we really are in Christ. So the question then becomes, how does my spiritual gift add to the story that God wants to write in my life?
Movies are a common language that we all share, and this series will allow us to use something that is mostly secular to have new conversations about the truth of Scripture. This is a great series to invite a friend who might be hesitant to come to church. So reach out to that friend or neighbor who you have been thinking about inviting for weeks. Also, as you saw online, we can't show the movie clips online because of copyright restrictions. So if you want the full experience with the movie clips, on campus is a great option. If you were visiting on campus or watching online for the first time, be sure to learn more about us by texting FHNEW to 72000. We would love to have you be a part of our family. Now let's stand for our closing blessing. And if you're doing church at home or watching online, do the discussion questions to go a little deeper.
Lord, none of us have been bit by a radioactive spider, but we all have been redeemed by the blood of Christ, and that makes us into something we never imagined. Let us live in it and walk in it according to your will and purpose. Amen. God bless you guys, and see you next Sunday.
Songs of praise. From his wounds I will not go, from his perfect love. Stay the course, keep faith and know God has overcome. Awake my soul, awake my soul. See the Lord in on high, set your mind above, his pierced hands and wounded side, call for all my love, awake my soul, awake my soul, praise the Lord Almighty, sing his praise again, lift your eyes to Jesus, we lift our hearts. Rise up like the morning, come and bless his name, because our God is worthy, awaken songs of praise. Face is rising, glory returning, he deserves our praise. He deserves our praise. Hope is stirring. Christ is returning. He deserves our praise. He deserves our praise. Faith is rising. Glory returning. You deserve our praise. You deserve our praise. To Jesus, we lift our hearts to him. Rise up like the morning, come and bless his name, because our God is worthy. Awaken songs and praise the Lord Almighty. Sing his praise again. Lift your eyes to Jesus, we lift our hearts to him. Rise up like the morning, come and bless his name, because our God is worthy, awaken songs of praise. Oh, awaken songs of praise. Awaken songs of praise.
turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the dark,